Thank you for the intro. We know each other. Thank you for the introduction. Yes, I would like also to thank the speaker, the organizers, for giving me the opportunity to give this talk. It was worth waiting to meet in person for this conference. So this result is based on a joint work with Giulia Basti, which is now at GSSI in L'Aquila, Domenico Finco and Alessandro Teta, which are both in Rome, Sandro at Sapienza and Domenico at Uninettuno. Okay, the topic of this talk is the definition of this Hamiltonian. This represents an Hamiltonian for three bosons of unit mass in dimension 3 that interact through contact interactions. This pi 2-3 is the coincidence hyperplane of the particle 2 with the particle 3. Delta pi 2-3 is the Dirac delta distribution supported on this hyperplane. And here alpha is an interaction parameter that plays the role of the inverse of the two-body scattering length with a minus. Now, this is a pictorial representation of this Hamiltonian, because you know that you cannot just add delta distributions to the Laplacian, so this mu here represents a renormalization constant that depends on alpha. Okay, this has to be defined rigorously. Since I'm working with bosons, the wave function psi will be in L2 symmetric that we have just seen and also seen in the book of Seilinger, which is the space of functions which satisfy this identity where P is any permutation of the coordinates x1, x2. And x3. Okay. Just to set the notation, I will move now to the so-called Jacobi coordinates. I remind you what they are. So you take the center of mass of the three particles. You define x as the relative position of the particle 2 with respect to the particle 3, and y as the relative position of the center of mass of the particle 2 and 3 with respect to the particle 1. So that I will get rid of the center of mass and work in these two variables. Notice that 2 coinciding with 3 is x equal to 0. 1 coinciding with 3 is y equal to x over 2. And 1 coinciding with 2 is y equal to minus x over 2. Okay, so you keep your pictorial representation of the Hamiltonian. You move to the center of mass. You get the Laplacian with respect to the variable center of mass, and then you get an interacting term where the deltas are now concentrated on the coincidence hyperplanes in the variable x and y. And of course, the wave function is still to have this symmetry, bosonic symmetry, which is translated in these identities. This is the exchange of particle 2 and 3, and this is a cyclic permutation of the three particles in this variable. So my functions will satisfy these identities. Okay, since we have not seen it, one slide on the two-body case, you probably all know this part. I will go very quickly. So the problem is very simple in the two-body case, which is reduced to the one-body case in the relative coordinate. How do you define this Hamiltonian? Rigorously, you take a symmetric operator, which is the Laplacian on functions which are zero, and smooth and zero on the coincidence hyperplane in x equal to zero. This is symmetric with and it has a one parameter family of self-adjoint exchange. It has defect indices 1-1, that's it. So it's a domain is run by functions, which have a regular part, which means in H2, past a singular term, and the singular term, which is proportional to a number, xi, is related to the value of the regular part by this this relation. This evaluated in zero is equal to alpha plus root of lambda xi. And this alpha is the interaction parameter. The operator on the wave function acts in this way. It's the Laplacian plus lambda on the regular part. And of course, you can say something about the behavior of this function for x that goes to zero. This dates back to Bethe and Peirce, 1928-9, I think. So for x that goes to zero, this function behaves like that. The, it has a singular part proportional to xi, and then a finite term, which if you use this relation is alpha times xi plus the terms that go to zero. Okay. Now, you want to model the Hamiltonian that you want to construct for the three-body problem on this two-body interaction. That is the original idea that dates back to Ter, Martirosyan, Skornyakov. So what one would do, would, one would take a symmetric operator, which is this Laplacian, on functions which are smooth and zero on the coincidence hyperplanes with the symmetry condition, and look for self-adjoint extensions of this operator. And of course here you have infinity, you are in a situation in which the defect spaces have infinite dimension. So you have a very large family of self-adjoint extensions. So you would like to select the ones that satisfy the correct behavior of the wave functions, meaning that when two particles, for example, particle 2 and 3 go near to each other, x goes to zero, the wave function behaves as in the two-body interaction. Of course, here, this xi will not be a number, will be a function that depends on the other coordinate. Similar behavior on the other two coincidence planes, since the problem is symmetric. Okay, the construction of this operator is actually very problematic, and it turns out that if you look for Hamiltonians, self-adjoint Hamiltonians, that satisfy just this condition, you will get an operator which is only symmetric, so it has a one parameter, one defect indices, and a one parameter family of self-adjoint extensions, and all the self-adjoint extensions that satisfy then this condition are unbounded from below. There is a sequence of eigenvalues that go to minus infinity. This is basically the result of Milnos and Faddeyev. There is a misprint here of 1962, which was based on the original idea of Ter, Martirosyan and Skornyakov, and some observation of Danilov that first noticed that there is this problem with the eigenvalues going to minus infinity. And this problem with the eigenvalues going to minus infinity is known as Thomas effect, and it's a problem related to the fall in the center, so that all the particles coming together, that is where it comes from. Then there was a lot of work on these Hamiltonians, also outside the bosonic symmetry. I just dropped some names here. I'm not going to talk about the results in detail. What I'm interested in too is instead a little remark that Milnos and Faddeyev put at the end of their paper, because they say, okay, if you want to solve this unboundedness from below problem, there is a recipe which says take your parameter alpha and turn it to into something plus an operator, k. And this operator k is an operator that in Fourier transform is a convolution operator, and that's kernel of this form. P is the Fourier variable associated to y, to the coordinate y. Okay? And they say if you take a gamma large enough and also give a threshold for this gamma, you will see that the Hamiltonian corresponding to this parameter for the self-adjoint extension is bounded from below. They don't give the proof, they just this is a four-line statement. And about 20 years later, something similar is remarked in a paper by Albevero, Krohn, and Wu, that in which they say, okay, you want to get an unbounded from below Hamiltonian, change alpha in alpha plus gamma tilde over y, take gamma tilde large enough, you will get an Hamiltonian bounded from below. Obviously, the two recipes are the same. This is just this one in Fourier transform. And here it's clear what is happening. Alpha is the inverse of the scattering length. So when alpha goes to infinity, the scattering length goes to zero, then the interaction is disappearing. And this is what is happening here when y goes to zero. So when the third particle comes on the center of mass of the other two particles, the interaction switches off and this avoids the fall to the center phenomenon. Still, no proof was given in Albevero, Krohn, and Wu. So what the first thing that we wanted to do was to give a construction of this regularized version of the TMS Hamiltonian. TMS stands for the boundary condition, the asymptotic condition for x going to zero that one wants to give. Okay, so our idea is follows exactly what was said in the papers that I mentioned. We choose as an parameter alpha plus if an operator, which is a multiplication operator in the space y, which is gamma over y times a function on which we assume that it's bounded and goes to one as y goes to zero, and it is Lipschitz in the origin. That's what you need to assume. For example, a function that is one for in an interval near the origin and zero outside would work. Now, to define this Hamiltonian, we don't work with the self-adjoint extension theory. We will decide to work with the quadratic form. So we now construct a quadratic form that is supposed to be the quadratic form for the operator we are looking for. So we define this operator, which is an operator that maps L2, that goes from L2 over 3 into L2 over 6, and it's defined in this way. It is G to 3 on Xi is the distributional solution, the solution of this distributional equation. And of course, you can define in the similar way G31, G12, taking the correct delta interaction. We will call Xi charge or charge density. And then we can add these three operators and get the potential generated by this charge density Xi on distributing on the three coincidence hyperplanes. Okay, so we get we construct this object, which is kind of simple in Fourier transform. It has this expression here. I will work in Fourier transform every now and then. Okay, now we look for functions which have this decomposition in a regular part plus a singular part, which is now played by this object, and we impose the boundary condition where alpha is replaced by our gamma R that was That was this. R stays for regularized. Okay. So you impose this condition starting from this form of the wave function, and you get an expression in Fourier transform that relates xi to the evaluation of the regular part in the origin in Fourier space. Okay. There is a 1 over x term that cancels by the asymptotics for y, for x going to 0 in the G2-3 term. This is the second order expansion for this going for x going to 0, the finite part. And this is the contribution of the other hyperplanes in x equal to 0 in Fourier transform. And this is just the Fourier transform of this object that appears in the equation. Okay, so we get an equation of this form, and now we look for a quadratic form for the operator. So assuming that the operator acts in this way of on the wave function, you can write psi h psi, add and subtract lambda, and then with starting from here and a few lines of formal calculations, you get this identity, where here appears the free part of the quadratic form on the regular part of the wave function, Fourier transform. And here, there appears a quadratic form on the charges, xi, which is exactly the one related to the right and the left hand side of this equation. Okay. Because we have imposed the boundary condition in this calculation. Okay, now we take this object as our starting point, as a quadratic form to define the Hamiltonian. And the first step is to analyze this quadratic form. And we find out that there is a threshold explicit such that if you take gamma larger than this threshold, and then you take some lambda large enough, there are two constants such that this quadratic form is coercive and bounded from above. Once that you have this result, you can take you can define another quadratic form, this time on the functions psi, like in this way. You can you have to now make it formal and give a domain for this quadratic form, which you guess from what you know from the point interactions should be done by a regular part and a singular part. The regular part is taken in H1, the singular part, the charge is taken in H1 half, where we work with this quadratic form. And you can prove that this quadratic form is bounded from below and closed using these bounds. Then to it, it is associated a self-adjoint operator whose domain is written here. I'm missing the decomposition of psi in W lambda plus psi G lambda in the definition of the domain, but this is the boundary regularity of the charge and the boundary condition, and here is the action of the operator. So this is a definition of this lower bounded regularized the term Artirosian Skornyakov Hamiltonian. The main idea for the construction with the quadratic forms came from a paper from Figari and Teta. There is an analogous result based on the methods of self-adjoint extension theory for symmetric operators in several papers, so Michelangelo in particular one. And recently, Ferretti and Teta, and this is Daniele Ferretti, a student of Sandro, showed that actually this threshold is optimal, in the sense that if you take gamma smaller than gamma c, the quadratic form is not bounded from below. They use a test function argument. Okay, now I have about 10. So I would now say something on the way to approximate this Hamiltonian with the regular Hamiltonian. We do that using the so-called separable potentials or non-local potentials. And to do that, we choose a function psi. Here, I took it in S, but this is too much. You can just say some decay at infinity, spherically symmetric, real valued, non-negative, and with the integral equal to 1. Given this function, you can define a parameter L in this way. And then you rescale the function with the scaling that is typical to get something that converges to a delta. And also you define not the coupling constant, but an operator, g epsilon of y, in this way, in terms of this gamma regularizing and of this parameter, this constant L that you introduced before. Now, the potentials, the separable potentials that you're going to use are written like this, which means that they take a function psi, they integrate it to psi in L2 of R3, you get the function of y, which is multiplied by g and chi of epsilon. So this is not a rank one operator because there are two variables, but in the variable x is a rank one operator. I'm going also to use this operator S, which is the operator that exchanges the set of labels 1, 2, 3 in the labels 2, 3, 1. So it means that it acts on functions in this way. This is the symmetry that you have seen at the beginning. And then you can define an Hamiltonian, which is now defined on H2 as the free part plus a term, which is the sum of three terms. Defined as before, taking into account that in the second and third you have to exchange the particles. Now, here we have to assume some more regularity on theta, a bit of smoothness. Also, we have to take a slightly larger gamma. This constant C can be computed explicitly in terms of psi. It must be larger than 2 anyway, so this gamma must be larger than the gamma critical that we had before. And in this setting, we can prove that the resolvent of H epsilon converges to the resolvent of H, our operator, with the speed of convergence also, epsilon to delta. I mean, I will skip this. To do that, it's clear that it must work, and one has to do some estimates to prove that it works. One way to do it is to write g epsilon as the product of two terms, nu epsilon times nu epsilon star. It's easy to see that this product is just a function product. It gives exactly g epsilon. And in this way, you have your Hamiltonian that is written in this form, an operator, free Hamiltonian, sum of three terms, Sj, an operator times the adjoint. So the Hamiltonian is basically in this form. If you don't worry too much about the definitions of these objects, you can compute the resolvent and you get an explicit expression like this one. Assuming that everything is well defined, obviously. So we apply this formula to this Hamiltonian, and you will get something like this, where this object comes out from this inverse in which you put mu equal to minus 4 pi epsilon over L and also kappa equal to this operator, taking into account that there is an identity, this one, in which this first term, which is divergent in epsilon, is cancelled by the fact that L is exactly how you chose it. L is chi without epsilon, is chi inverse of the Laplacian chi. And if you expand this operator, you rewrite this operator as minus the Laplacian plus something, you actually get something that compensates this, plus a reminder that you can compute and gives you this gamma epsilon. Okay. Now this gamma epsilon it has an explicit expression. It's here. This does not depend on epsilon, it's the usual one. Then two terms that depend on epsilon. And if you look at them, they clearly give you the limit operators when epsilon goes to zero. So you just have to work out this limit for epsilon going to zero. The resolving formula also appear some operators of the form A epsilon, which are defined like that, like the resolvents applied to this operator K, which in our case has this form. Remember that this goes to a delta in dimension 3, so this converges. And the gamma nu epsilon goes to 1, so this converges to G to 3. Of course, in this formula, I didn't prove that this operator is well defined, in particular that this operator is invertible. So before to write this formula, I should be sure that this operator is actually invertible. Okay, and now one thinks, okay, this is must be so because this converges to gamma, this converges to 1 in the limit this operator gamma, which is the self-adjoint operator associated to the form on the charges, is lower bounded, so this is invertible. Okay, so you can prove that this is actually the case. You have to be a bit careful because gamma can be small. When y goes to 0, this goes to infinity. This is the inverse, so gamma can be small. So this nu can be small. So you have to show that this as a whole is actually no problems in it's invertible, and this is what we actually do, and what it turns out to be the right inequality is this inequality on gamma epsilon, which is a lower bound for its quadratic form. Here you are in L2 over 3, and this is just a multiplication for 1 over y. Okay, in this lower bound it played the role, the fact that this has a term of order 1 over y, and the diagonal term doesn't help you much, because if you look at how this is done, and well, it's possible to see that if you take p to infinity, this does not actually go as p at infinity. These are at infinity decays, and so this does not help you much for the p large. So what does the job is actually the 1 over y here. Okay. So once that you have this lower bound, you get the lower bound on this term that guarantees you that this inverse is well defined, and then you can start analyzing the convergence term by term to the resolvent of the limit operator, which has a similar form. This convergence term by term. Well, that is technical. I will not discuss it. I just want to mention that, of course, the more interesting problem will be to study a local approximation of this Hamiltonian. With this potential, which is a real potential, that scales in this way. Of course, you have to guess what is the right constant here. Problem is rather complicated because V a stable zero energy resonance, if you know about how a delta interaction is approximated in dimension 3. So we didn't get to this to the convergence of this operator to H. This problem can instead be solved in one dimension. We did it in this paper. Then there is also a paper from Grisime and collaborators which works with n particles and bosons, and also in dimension 2, again by Grisime and collaborators. In dimension 3 is still open even in this boundary from below case. Okay, these are some references that I mentioned. Thank you for your attention.